we're finally ready to colonize space.
No, not yet.
Nope.
But we're so close to being able to colonize space.
No.
Well, then how close are we?
So we thought it was something that might happen in our lifetimes, and now we don't think that.
What if everything you thought you knew about space colonization was wrong?
Everything that's outside of you could kill you.
Try to imagine dust that, if you put it under a microscope, looks like knives. It's not going to be a good time.
They would be baked by radiation in there.
There's no gravity. Fluids rush up. Your face poofs out. It seems to cause vision damage.
Oven hot to, like, way colder than your freezer. So, you know, you unpressurize the front door and everybody is dead.
It's experimenting on babies. You shouldn't do it.
These two killjoys are Zach and Kelly Weinersmith, authors of A City on Mars, an illustrated book that takes a serious look at how difficult space colonization really is.
So it sucks there, it's not even that free, and we're going to be drinking each other's recycled urine.
That's right. That's right, yes.
So if we're not ready to colonize space yet, how do we get there? Well, find out. This is Hard Reset, a series about rebuilding our world from scratch. Zach and Kelly Weinersmith started out as space enthusiasts, but they found themselves turning into space bastards.
So I'm curious why you call yourselves space bastards.
Okay. So when we started writing this book, our plan was to write a book about how space settlement is awesome and it's going to be happening soon. And the more research we did, the more we were like, oh, that doesn't seem right to us. And we're not as optimistic about this, or we're not as optimistic about that. And we kept being like the wet blankets at every conversation. And that kind of made us feel like bastards.
Yeah.
But I think a lot of people will look at a picture of the moon or Mars and think, oh, that kind of looks like some habitats we have on Earth. It's sort of like the desert, and we can survive in the desert. So we know how to do stuff like that. But space is actually way worse than it looks from just photos.
One thing to consider is that space is probably worse than you think. The environments we'll encounter on other planets or in deep space are not just harsher versions of what we have on Earth. In some ways, they're actively hostile to all life as we know it, more hostile than practically any environment on Earth.
So, what kind of problems do you encounter in space? Well, there's dramatic temperature swings when you're anywhere that doesn't have an atmosphere.
There's no magnetosphere protecting you from deadly cosmic radiation.
We don't understand the impacts of microgravity on the human body, and partial gravity on the moon or Mars might solve that problem, but we don't understand the problem very well yet. So maybe your bones will be degrading your whole life? Places like the moon and Mars are covered with regolith, which is jagged glass, which might scar your lungs if you breathe it in. And the dust on Mars is toxic with endocrine disruptors.
Yeah, and then so when you get a dust storm, it's a toxic sun-blotting out dust storm.
And your plants pick it up, so you better make sure that you get it out of the soil before you start your greenhouse, otherwise your kids are gonna be eating it.
Yeah,
so not great.
So not great.
Not great, yeah.
Get another one from the tank?
Yeah, get a handful. Yeah, so one way we like to say that is it's like you are part of a 4 billion year evolutionary process to live in this place in particular. So you are very fine-tuned for a small part of one place, maybe in the whole universe.
The lesson here is that we should appreciate how awesome the Earth is for us, which isn't surprising when you remember it's the environment we're specifically adapted to thrive in. Between the atmosphere, the magnetosphere, and the easy access to chemicals and nutrients that we need to survive, it's hard to imagine how we could make Earth even close to as bad as space.
If someone gave you $1 trillion and said, ruin Earth as thoroughly as Mars is ruined, I don't think you could do it short of like slamming the moon into Earth. If you really worked hard on runaway climate change and got some comets going,
smash,
throw nuclear war on top. I think
werewolves.
You could add some werewolves and zombies and a worldwide plague and maybe a blob monster. Get the core to stop, get rid of the atmosphere. So maybe if you could produce like a supernova pretty close that could just strip out the atmosphere, there's a risk that, you know, there'll be some carbon dioxide coming out of animals and then plants will get it and they'll sort of, someone will survive. So I don't know, maybe another blast of radiation to like double tap the ecosphere.
That might have been overkill.
It's fine.
Going to space will mean taking a lot of the Earth with us, all to recreate the environments that we have here for free. That will be expensive and difficult. And even though we know it's possible in theory, it's not something we can do in practice yet. There are huge gaps in our knowledge about how to live in space over the long term.
It's not that we want humans to never start space settlements, but we really feel like there's a bunch of groundwork that needs to be laid before we start space settlements. And maybe the most scary example is having babies in space. At the end of the day, we know very little about mammalian reproduction in space and even less about human reproduction in space. So if you send humans to Mars, it's quite possible that a lot of things are going to go wrong. But we can fill in a lot of these gaps before we go. So we could start a research station on the moon, and we could have a rodent colony and ensure that, you know, they survive for 10 generations without any weird problems.
Like, this is a very basic issue that if you send 10,000 people to space without answering these questions, you're effectively experimenting on babies at scale, which I don't know any ethical system that would countenance that. So it's not like a wishy-washy, gee, I don't know, I'm clutching my pearls about these awesome adventures going to space and not distributing the rewards or something. It's experimenting on babies. You shouldn't do it.
And this is your backup for humanity. Like, if we have a backup for humanity, but they're awful, do we want a backup for humanity? Like, let's wait and make sure that backup has, you know, a little bit more care for the value of human life.
So how do we take humanity to the stars? How do we learn the things we need in order to successfully colonize space? You've probably heard of Biosphere. And no, I don't mean the Pauly Shore movie Biodome.
Whoa, check out that mall, man.
Which was maybe a little bit more fun than the real thing.
Just because we're stuck in a bubble doesn't mean we can't cause any trouble.
Biosphere was supposed to be a closed-loop system. A self-sustaining ecosystem for 8 people.
It was easily the largest attempt to create the exact kind of thing you're going to want on Mars to have a self-sustaining society. It was a greenhouse that had a footprint of 3.14 acres, an enormous greenhouse, but unlike a normal greenhouse, it was sealed. So they built this thing. They actually built this thing. It cost something like over $100 million to build this grand experiment to see if you could stick 8 people in for 2 years without them ever coming out. They would grow their own food, generate their own oxygen, clean their waste. They would even like process wheat. There was an underground basement with a server bank that was monitoring things.
So the original plan with Biosphere was that you were going to do these 2-year runs over and over and over again, and each time we'd get better at it, and we would sort of tune the system, and we'd get information that would be helpful for when you get to Mars.
It was an audacious experiment. It got a ton of media attention, and as we mentioned already, inspired a better-than-average Pauly Shore movie. But mostly, Biosphere 2 is remembered as a failure.
There are rumors of, like, liquor bottles, and there was a lot of infighting, not only among the crew, but between the crew and management, and between factions and management. It was a real disaster socially.
Like, they were spitting on each other.
At one point,
like,
they were spitting on each
how
other.
How much they didn't like each other.
So they didn't talk to each other for about a year, these two factions.
And they started calling out for psychiatrists, which they weren't supposed to do, but they couldn't handle it otherwise.
Yeah. So,
which, can't blame them.
They were also quite skinny. If you see pictures of them from the end, they look quite gaunt. So I think it's usually remembered as just a sort of disaster. Yeah, it was bad.
But the disastrous reputation obscures the bigger point, which is that Biosphere 2 generated a ton of valuable data. And that's the whole point of an experiment like this.
And with all that, it basically worked. 8 people went in, 8 people came out. It is the closest thing we have to a place where we attempted to create a sealed closed-loop ecology at scale. It is the closest thing to something we'll have to do on a much larger scale if you ever want a chance at putting a community on Mars or on the moon.
In fact, the biggest failure of the Biosphere project may just be that we didn't keep it going. Biosphere actually showed that it is possible to live in a closed-loop system. And if we did it more than once, we might actually start to get good at it.
If we had done it again every 2 years, by now we would have had something like a flowchart. We would have known species that don't work or don't work together. We would have maybe known, like, maybe having 5 biomes is kind of goofy and we should have just focused on ag. We would have had, you know, if not a science, something like a list of best practices, like a textbook. You can imagine a world in which NASA or some other organization was tasked with the specific job of space settlement. And there, I think one of the first things we'd say to do is either just buy Biosphere and keep running it or spin up a similar facility at different scales, because the problem is going to take so very long to solve.
So space is a terrible place for humans, and it's expensive and difficult to get there. The nicest spots are both very far away and still terrible by any human standard. So will we actually ever colonize other planets or stars? Maybe. But it'll be harder than you think, and you should be prepared to wait a long time.
We argue wait and go big is a better way to go in general. It's less Heinlein, it's more Star Trek. It's not a hard scrabble awesome thing that we're going to do. It's going to be something we can do when it is easy and enjoyable.
Getting to the point where we can colonize space will mean developing technologies to clean our water and our air, prevent and reverse diseases, and use energy with incredible efficiency. It will mean vastly expanding our understanding of human biology and how ecosystems work. It will require huge improvements in material sciences, robotics, and biotech. In other words, it will make life on Earth much better and vastly improve our quality of life, and that's much more valuable than any resources we might find on the moon or in the asteroid belt.
The World Bank estimated that something like 2-6% of the world's wealth comes from the actual, like, resources. So all of the rest of the wealth is ideas from our institutions and the conversations we have with each other.
A good example is these 2-nanometer chips, maybe the most complicated things humans have ever built. It's a global endeavor. It requires companies from Europe, from Asia, from America, all over the world to get together to make these extraordinarily complicated things, and we all do it together. And that's where our wealth comes from. And you can convince yourself of this by taking an iPhone and thinking about what it's made of. It's made of, like, hydrocarbons and glass and cheap stuff. It's the organization of the stuff that's really valuable. And space is not going to change that.
So space exploration does still hold the promise of unlocking incredible wealth, but maybe not in the way you think. In fact, if we do it right, what we take to the stars will be far more valuable than anything we find there.
So space is often unhygienic, because in zero gravity, poop doesn't always stay in the right place.
I don't know how relevant that is, though, because the moon or Mars are rotating space station. Poop's gonna...
Yeah, it's gonna go the right direction.
Yeah. I don't think we need to oversell
the poop problems.
We could talk about poop, though.
Yeah, it's an option.
Yeah, we wouldn't hold back the good stuff.